Hello, everyone, and welcome. Thanks for joining us. My name is Pam, and I am here with Jody, and we will be hosting, moderating this session. So you're here just to make sure you're in the right place. You're here for the session, genetic testing for inherited syndromes and newly diagnosed non-medullary thyroid cancer in young patients, including PTEN and DICER1 related syndromes. I'm very pleased to announce our speaker for this session. Dr. Yuri Nikiforov is Vice Chair for Molecular Pathology and Director of the Division of Molecular and Genomic Pathology at the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Dr. Nikiforov oversees the operations of the Molecular and Genomic Pathology Laboratory in the Clinical Lab Building. He also serves as co-director of the Multidisciplinary Thyroid Center at UPMC. His clinical expertise is in surgical pathology of the thyroid gland and in molecular testing of thyroid tumors. His research is focused on thyroid cancer genetics and mechanisms of chromosomal rearrangements and other mutations induced by ionizing radiation in thyroid cells and other cell types. Dr. Nikiforov is a ThyCa medical advisor. So with that, again, I'm pleased to welcome Dr. Nikiforov.
Thank you very much, Pam, and good morning, everybody. It is my really pleasure to participate in this great, it's not the first time I'm participating, and always enjoy interacting with you and discussing various aspects of related to thyroid diseases. Today we are going to talk about genetic testing for inherited syndromes. Basically, I want to bring your attention and discuss those relatively rare, but still not so rare situations when thyroid cancer occurs as part of the inherited disease, which is really important to recognize, and it has implications for children and siblings typically of in the family. So I want to start reviewing overall. This is a busy table and we are not going through the entire table, but this is just summarizes what is the current state of knowledge about inherited or familial forms of thyroid cancer. Again, cancers that occur due to genetic alterations that are inherited from parents to their children. Many of you probably know that the most common type of the inherited cancer in thyroid is medullary thyroid carcinoma. And this is due to mutation in the RET gene. We are not going to talk about this specific cancer types. And I know that every year there are a good number of talks about medullary carcinoma. And this is something which is relatively well known. But I want to talk today and focus on a couple of diseases that are less common and less known, not only for patients, I want to stress, but even for the physicians, less known. And still it's very important for all of us to recognize that this can happen because it has significant implications for the patient and for their families. Specifically, I want to talk today about two such syndromes. One is called PTEN hamartoma tumor syndrome, and second is a DICER1 syndrome. So overall, when we should suspect familial disease, and this is not related specifically to thyroid, this is for all physicians, that's how we are taught, in what situations we need to suspect that the disease may be inherited, cancer can be inherited. When tumor occur at younger age, younger than expected age. So always when patients are in their 20s and even earlier or even in their 30s, again, little bit depends on the cancer type, but we always have to think little bit more sort of carefully to exclude the familial disease. When there are more tumors than normal, which means that there are more than one tumor, when patient at younger age develop one or two or three tumors. So that's also another situation when we have to really think about genetic counseling, about considering a familial occurrence. of disease, when tumors match some of the known specific syndromes. That is a third condition, and we are going to talk a little bit about this. So these are three situations when really globally, generally, we have to be cognizant and have to think about familial disease. If you talk about thyroid in a little bit more sort of a specific and yet simple way, when we see bilateral multiple thyroid nodules or tumors occurring within the thyroid at younger age, that for us is always should be a red flag that we may be dealing with a familial disease. Now we are going to talk, like I said, about two specific syndromes. One is a DICER1 syndrome. This is a relatively new, relatively recently discovered. DICER gene has been discovered, you know, about 20 years ago or less. We didn't even know about it, you know, before the early 2000s. So, and now we know that this causes an inherited syndrome that is called DICER1 syndrome, which lead to the increased risk of a variety of cancerous and non-cancerous tumors, most commonly occurring in lung, kidney, ovaries, and thyroid. And these tumors are very, very rare type, very unusual type of tumors, and usually they occur in very young children. So it's caused by a germline or inherited mutation in the DICER gene. Importantly, that individuals can develop one or more tumor types, and it's a very unusual, even clinically very unusual syndrome, because different family members may develop different tumor types, and this kind of a more confusing, more difficult to glue the picture together. And the risk of tumor formation in individuals with these mutations that is inherited is actually relatively low. It's only moderately increased over the general populations. And that's another reason why many of these syndromes are, the patients with these syndromes are overlooked. Very briefly, I want to say that this DICER1 syndrome is characterized by tumors that are different in young, very, very young children and in older individuals. In very young children, like I said, it's a very, very rare, very unusual type of tumors, like pulmonary pleuroblastomas or pituitary blastomas or Sertoli-Leydig tumors of ovary. Okay, and this usually occur at very young age, 2 years, 3 years, 6 years old. And when the patients grow, I mean, individuals grow older, then the risk of these very strange tumors practically disappears. And in individuals over like 20, 25 year age, practically the only disease manifestation that of DICER syndrome can be thyroid nodules, multiple thyroid nodules. So DICER1 syndrome in the thyroid can manifest as a just multinodular goiter, multiple benign nodules, as follicular adenoma, as papillary carcinoma, as follicular carcinoma. So really a variety of different histological tumor types that can be observed. But almost always there are some multiple nodules in both lobes of the thyroid. And recently we described, unfortunately, a much more aggressive, because these all types of cancer, papillary and follicular, they are not very aggressive. But recently we described an aggressive, poorly differentiated carcinoma in young children and adolescents that is driven by DICER1 gene. I am not going to bore you with a lot of technical details, but just want to say that also genetic testing for this gene is challenging. We test for mutations in DICER1 that occur as a somatic event in nodules, means not inherited, but just environmental cause. But then we suspect that some of the genes that have this, you know, somatic mutation may also have a germline or inherited mutation in the DICER gene. So in fact, this is a paper that we just published this year when we looked at prevalence of DICER mutation in thyroid nodules in adults. We look at large population of adult patients with thyroid nodules with indeterminate cytology. And we found that about 1.4% of all of them had DICER1 so-called hotspot or somatic mutation. So this is a relatively high if you think how thyroid nodules are common, benign, most of them are benign, how common this mutation is. And then we were investigating subset of these tumors, and we found these nodules rather, and found that in 3/4 of them, there will be another mutation that actually can be germline. So in reality, still a smaller fraction of them will be germline, but the bottom line is that a number of thyroid nodules and thyroid tumors developing in adults, in patients, I'm not even taking the 20s because it still can be considered kind of a young individual from 30s to 60s, still can be a manifestation of DICER1 syndrome. And these individuals can pass their genes to their children. So that's kind of important. They no longer are at risk for this strange disease that occur in pediatric age, but their children may be at risk. And this is one of the reasons why I think it is important to follow and to do genetic counseling and maybe the testing of patient blood to be sure that we exclude this possibility. So when we should suspect DICER1 syndrome, when patients develop thyroid nodules at younger age, when there are multiple thyroid nodules and thyroid cancer, on ultrasound, on the pathology removed, we see really multiple nodules. And when there is personal or family history of tumors that also occur in the same individuals, again, or in family members in the lung or kidney or ovary, particularly during childhood. So if these three or two out of these three sort of conditions are seen, it is generally a good idea to think about the DICER1 syndrome and go through genetic counseling and blood tests for DICER1 mutation. That's all for DICER1, and I just go and also briefly review PTEN hamartoma tumor syndrome. This is another relatively common syndrome that affects also thyroid. So there are multiple historical names that now, believed to be considered a separate disease. Now we know that this is all part of this PTEN hamartoma tumor syndrome. Most common is Cowden's syndrome, Cowden's disease. So this disease is caused by germline mutation in the PTEN tumor suppressor gene. Okay, maybe de novo, like most mutations, may be developed just in this individual as the first, time. So these patients are at higher risk for breast, thyroid, bowel, and skin cancer, and also some benign tumors and tumor-like malformations. And also manifestations vary greatly from person to person, can develop at any age, and therefore it is more difficult to diagnose this syndrome. It's a relatively common, as you see, estimated prevalence is 1 in 200,000 individuals, equally men and women are affected. More commonly found in person of party has no any racial or ethnic predilection. So what is the spectrum of thyroid disease in patients with this PTEN hamartoma tumor syndrome? Also, it's also very, it's a nodular disease, but that can present in multiple form. It can be multiple adenomatous nodules, can be or adenomas multiple, can be papillary carcinoma, Hashimoto thyroiditis alone, follicular carcinoma, C-cell hyperplasia, follicular adenoma. Again, the same general approach that we have to think about this syndrome when there are multiple nodules. When patients go to for ultrasound and they say, oh, you know what, you have really in both lobes multiple nodules, and patient is a younger age, that's the situation when really we need to think about this, a possibility of this syndrome. I just show you my one microscopic slide. I am a pathologist, so I cannot speak for more than 10 minutes, not showing any pathology slides, but I promise it just one that I'm going to show you. You see, it's basically a section of the thyroid gland, and you see this is one nodule, and this is the second, and this is the third, and this is fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, and there is this multiple more. So this, when you see this multiple, very well delineated nodules, and see them on ultrasound or after thyroid gland was removed, that's again situation when clinicians, as a pathologist, we have to think about PTEN hamartoma tumor syndrome. So in addition to thyroid, there are a number of other diseases that are associated with this syndrome. Pretty common are various skin and oral lesions, lipomas, so benign fatty tumors appearing in skin. There are other papillomas, acral keratosis, some papillomatous diseases of skin, mucosal papillomas, and so on, fibromas, and so on and so forth. When the patient has this multiple skin disease and then develops thyroid, multinodular thyroid, that's again a situation when we have to very carefully think about the possibility of this PTEN hamartoma tumor syndrome. So outside of the skin, these patients may develop gastrointestinal polyps, breast and uterine lesions is more common, benign and malignant. There is also macrocephaly is one of the manifestations that present in many, but not all of the patients. If you look at life risk, lifetime risk of cancer in these patients. So you see thyroid, there are about 35% risk of thyroid cancer. And there is even higher risk of breast, renal, and endometrial cancer. And you see that typical average age at presentation is in the 30s and 40s and 50s. So one of the reasons why it's so important for us to suspect if we see a thyroid with this multiple nodule to suspect PTEN hamartoma tumor syndrome, because this would mean that the patient have a high chance of other diseases, including, let's say, breast cancer, which can be prevented by careful screening. That's the reason. And thyroid sometimes can be a first manifestation of this syndrome. And that's why it's so important for us to think about it. So diagnosis of PTEN hamartoma tumor syndrome is suspected based on thorough clinical evaluation, detailed patient history. Again, we discussed multiple diseases at younger age. There is a mutation risk calculator available to estimate the risk of adults to have the syndrome. This is a website from the Cleveland Clinic. I mean, they are really they one of the centers who are leading the world in understanding of this disease, and including thyroid and non-thyroidal manifestation. But diagnosis can only be confirmed when a mutation in the PTEN gene is identified. And that's also universal for all inherited syndrome. At the end, you have to, this is a blood test, they collect your blood, and then the test for specific genes, and they tell you if this mutation is present or not present. I think I stop at this time. I think that this was just meant to give you a general background. I'll be happy to, you know, receive your comments or answer questions. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Very good presentation, very informative. We can get to, if it's okay with you, Dr. Nikiforov, maybe some of the questions here. So I can start with the first one. They're asking, there is little data in the literature for the natural course of thyroid cancer in Cowden patients. Have you seen aggressive histologies such as Herthal and Insular in your experience?
This is a very good question, and you're absolutely right. that the literature is relatively limited. I want to say that in our experience, we do not see aggressive histologies with PTEN hamartoma tumor syndrome. We do see some cancers. Most of them are minimally invasive follicular carcinomas or follicular variant papillary carcinomas. I want to draw a contrast with the DICER1 syndrome. In DICER1 syndrome, we clearly see a very small but subgroup of tumors that develop poorly differentiated carcinoma, which is really a bad tumor. No, typically another common name for poorly differentiated is insular carcinoma. So in PTEN, it's rarely seen. But I want just to mention one thing, that sometimes PTEN gene is mutated or altered together with other genes. And that's when this may be an issue. We've seen some aggressive histologies, including Hürter cell tumors, not in patients with PTEN hamartoma tumor syndrome, but patients with a somatic or acquired PTEN mutation in addition to other alterations. But again, if you're speaking specifically about PTEN hamartoma tumor syndrome, very clean, very pure disease as such, in my experience, very rarely we would see aggressive histology.
Okay, I'll go to the next question. We are PTEN positive on thyroid tissue and on liquid NGS. Do you have a recommendation for a specific type or brand of genetic testing that is better for Cowden?
So I want to say that I just took extra second to think about it. So basically what you are saying is that you have a PTEN mutation positive in thyroid tissue. Liquid NGS, I am not sure if you mean liquid biopsy, I don't know, but I mean, in any case, if I understand correctly, we are talking about, unless you're talking about the blood liquid NGS, so it is probably at this time, it's a somatic mutation. So you need to perform the germline testing to see if it's present in the blood or not. I don't believe that there are any difficulties in detecting it by modern molecular test. I think that there are multiple companies who offer germline testing for PTEN, and they would provide a reliable result for you.
Thank you.
Okay. I have a question, Dr. Nikiforov. This is kind of for myself. Our family tested positive for both a PTEN mutation in the promoter region as well as DICER1. And my daughter had thyroid cancer at 10. So I assume you would probably recommend, which we're doing, maybe some type of molecular testing on the nodule to determine if it was PTEN or DICER1, or maybe it would be a combination of the two.
I think that, we probably, if I'm not mistaken, talked, maybe a couple of years ago. And I mean, at that time I was, a little bit not surprised, but impressed, because it's not very often. I think that, I know probably like maybe two or three families that has both genes, because they're both relatively rare. So bottom line is that as far as I understand, you know the specific mutations in the PTEN and in DICER that you have. And obviously for children, it is important to follow and to know. I mean, there is PTEN is a recessive, so you need to lose two alleles. DICER is more complicated because there is an inherited inactivating mutations and then somatic activating mutations. So, definitely in these situations, you would like to know in your children specifically what mutations occur as in germline. And then if there is a question about, let's say, a thyroid nodule, also, I don't want to complicate it, but I want to say that let's talk about PTEN, for example. Typically, there are two copies of the PTEN gene, like two copies, like all genes present in two, a number of two. One comes from your mother and comes from your father. Mutation inherited is typically on one of these two alleles, is either on maternal or paternal. And this mutation predisposed to the disease, but the second gene still active and prevents the disease. And even in some cells, the second gene is also inactivated, we call it the second hit, then the full gene is inactivated and disease develops. So why I'm saying this, let's say there is a thyroid nodule, okay? There is a thyroid theoretically in such patients, and you stick a needle and you collect cells and you run it for molecular testing. Okay, if you find only inherited mutation and no second mutation developed, it means that the risk of progression to cancer in this nodule will be lower. If you have both germline mutation and you have a new second allele inactivation, the risk of progression will be higher. That's in a, you obviously have even more complex family situation because you have also DICER mutation, and that's very difficult to know the interplay. But in principle, almost for sure, almost all in all situations, in addition to the baseline inherited mutation, there will be an additional somatic hit, somatic mutation. And by searching for those, you can predict higher or lower likelihood of progression.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much.
I think that you, Dr. Nikiforov, that you kind of answered this next question, but I'm going to read it anyway, just in case. What are the implications of PTEN and DICER1 somatic mutations in lesser mutations from one parent as far as disease progression and behavior? I think that might be what you touched on, but I want to make sure.
Yeah, probably I believe that yes, indeed. So again, I mean, this mutation, one of the mutations predisposes to the, has a higher, I mean, high predisposition to developing disease. But then for the disease to develop, it should be a loss of the second allele, which then progress, that pushes the cell to grow and to progress to typically tumoral condition.
Okay. If you have a clinical diagnosis of Cowden, do you need to go through genetic testing for this?
So if you have a clinical diagnosis of Cowden disease, I would say that in my opinion, yes, because none of the syndromes, despite, I mean, some of them in some patients may have so characteristic clinical appearance that is practically diagnostic of this disease. And I maybe some of the geneticists and genetic counselors have a little bit different opinion, but in my opinion, you still have to have a molecular testing, because to be sure that you identify mutation, and not only that, because then this mutation can be tested in the family members and in children, because based on the different patterns of inheritance, it's never 100%, it's like 50% or even 25%. So what I'm saying is that I think that this is very important to have it on kind of on file, even if the clinical diagnosis is of Cowden's, to be sure that you know exactly where mutation is. And like I said again, I mean, family members can be tested for it.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so the next question, how does the risk of these two syndromes compare with the overall risk of familial thyroid cancer not associated with these specific mutations? And then I think a clarification, non-medullary.
So if we are talking about general, probably non-syndromic inherited thyroid cancer, we know that this is rare, maybe slightly more often than we thought before. We thought that familial non-syndromic thyroid cancer, you know, can be seen in less than 2% of, about 2% of all thyroid cancers. Now we think maybe it's between 2% and 5%. It's not clear, but it's low. So how it compares to these syndromes. When patient has a syndrome, one DICER, overall, you remember the data are more mature for PTEN hamartoma tumor syndrome. There is about what 35% probability the thyroid cancer will develop. So it's obviously still higher than the baseline non-syndromic patients. Okay. And I for DICER1 syndrome, this is data are still being collected. We don't know for sure. Okay. But I still want to stress that not all patients even with inherited mutation in DICER syndrome and with inherited mutation of PTEN syndrome will develop thyroid or any other manifestations. This is why even such a classical disease as medullary thyroid carcinoma, even this, you probably know that depending on the type of RET mutations, I mean, it can manifest, may some have higher probability, some have still lower probability, but this is a much, much stronger oncogenes. For PTEN and DICER, they are weaker oncogenes. So it's clinically, definitely a very big clinical variation. Many patients with both of this syndrome, particularly DICER1, will never develop thyroid nodules. That's why it's so difficult to diagnose. Some develop just benign disease and fewer will progress to cancer. So it's not like an absolute, it's not extremely high penetrance, which you know that it's, you know, almost for sure will develop. It's more like you have to, it's good still to good to have to be, to have a do diagnostics and be, because and be aware and just be cognizant that, okay, this is present. I'm at slightly higher risk, but I have to be more careful. I have to be being observed more carefully, being taken care of yourself more carefully. And again, there is no guarantee, I mean, thank God, you know, and there is no extremely high chance that everybody will develop these conditions.
Thank you. I have a related question that is really my question. And this is when you listed all of the reasons why you might suspect one of the syndromes, I didn't see, in my family, we have five of us who have had papillary thyroid cancer. Is the just the number of people at all a reason to investigate versus like the characteristics of one of the individuals, which seem to be your focus?
Yes, this is excellent point, Jody. And so if we talk about this sort of non-syndromic family, I assume that in your family there is no other diseases. It's just five family members have thyroid cancer, and pretty much they have mostly thyroid cancer. So it is still a call to exclude both of the syndromes that we discussed, you know, PTEN and DICER. I still think that it's important to exclude them. But after you excluded the syndromic, so you are talking about this. We are talking about the non-syndromic familial thyroid carcinoma. And this is, you're absolutely right. It is important. It is considered that if there are three, you know, family members affected by the disease, it's still by chance. If there is three or more, there is a more likely chance that there is a genetic component. Again, relatively weak genetic component, and we know a number of genetic loci, but still, this is an area of active research. We don't know exactly the genes that are responsible for this disease, but you are right. I probably should have mentioned that multiple family members affected by thyroid cancer would be also a sign that you have to look closer at the possibility of familial forms of disease.
Thank you.
Kind of expanding upon that, Dr. Nikiforov, can you specifically, I guess, from a genetic standpoint, can you tell, I know there's a lot of different variants out there, can you tell like if somebody tests positive for a PTEN or DICER1, I know they give you the specific mutation. Can you say with any certainty that if they have this specific DICER1 mutation at this level, they're more likely to develop thyroid nodules? If they have this mutation, they're more likely to develop lung cancer, this mutation, Sertoli-Leydig syndrome or tumors?
All right. Pam, I can tell you that you're asking a very, very insightful question. And I can tell you that I mean, prototype of what you're asking is in medullary carcinoma, because in medullary carcinoma, different mutations have slightly different chances to develop only like medullary carcinoma, to develop other manifestations of MEN2 syndrome. I can tell you that DICER is a relatively recently discovered disease. Mm-hmm. I am not aware, and I have to say that literature is also very scattered. I don't know if anybody has come with more specifics, but I don't think so. I sense that I can tell you what is the big difference between medullary carcinomas, red positive, and PTEN and DICER1 syndrome. I'll illustrate it based on this mm-hmm. slide. You see, a red mutation in medullary carcinomas is an activating mutation. It's mutation that activates an oncogene. And when it activates, there are very specific pathways how it activates and how this gene go to work to develop certain tumors, okay? Both PTEN and DICER1 syndromes, they are inactivating. This is a not oncogene, they're considered to be kind of a tumor suppressor genes. That function should be lost in order to this syndrome develop. And if you look for it, and this loss can happen at any part of the gene. So it's like, you know, you see, analogy can be that it's much easier to destroy something than to build, correct? It's much easier to take a vase and break it than to build a vase, because to build a vase, you need to look the same things here. To break this gene is very much easier than to activate it in a very specific way. You see on the bottom, these are mutations that are inherited mutation. You see all over the gene, almost every place where this gene can be broken and gene will not work. Mm-hmm. And the same is PTEN. You know, to find, and if you would look at, for example, and at red mutations, it would be more like this, very specific regions where this mutation occurred. So for these regions, when you see many mutations in these regions, it's much easier for you to try to understand how exactly this relates to specific diseases. When you have so many spots where gene can be inactivated, it becomes very difficult. Mm-hmm. So to a short answer on your question is that it's probably unlikely that we will be able to come with a specific, maybe when we have many patients, you know, genotype and have clinics, we will have some clusters, maybe mutations in this cluster is more likely to lead to this, and in that cluster is more likely to that. But it's not, I don't think that we are ready yet to answer this question.
Okay, so maybe someday.
Maybe someday.
Okay, thank you.
Someone has indicated I have Hürthle cell variant of papillary and possible DICER1 PTEN lesser mutation. Are there any new targeted therapies for these specific mutations?
No, there is no. There is no targeted therapies. We have targeted therapies. Again, targeted therapies, and this is time, very exciting time. It's a little bit easier to develop against activating genes. When gene is activated, let's say red gene, again, we're coming back to medullary carcinoma, it activates the function of the gene. And when it activates, it's easier for us to find a drug that will stop this activation. So imagine they come and cover the gene and will not allow to signal from the gene. So when we have syndrome that is related to inactivation, loss of function of multiple genes, it is much more difficult. Eventually, we will come to this. Eventually, we are talking about gene therapy. We can bring and reintroduce the function, reactivate the gene. So this is, should be the hope, that it's unlikely to be targeted therapies when we find inhibitors to inhibit like we found for it. But it's more likely will be gene therapy when we will be able to inject virus that brings this gene that will go to every cell and will start working and substitute the function of the broken gene. Mm-hmm. This is, we don't have it yet, but there is a hope that probably in the next 10 years, staying optimistic, something like this can appear.
Oh, that's exciting to hear. I can't wait for that to happen.
It is.
So we have another question. What about those of us who are tested and are positive for germline mutations like ATM, TP53, BRCA1, et cetera?
All right. Well, yes. We know that patients who have inherited deficiency of these genes that generally involve in DNA repair sort of do have an increased risk of different cancer types. Rarely thyroid, more likely others, but it can be also thyroid. Same thing, I mean, virtually all of them functions as a tumor suppressor genes. So when we lose the function, there is a higher probability that different type of cancer develop. The hope in terms of the gene therapy, again, is not a target inhibitor, it's a gene therapy. The hope is that one day we will be able to bring back a copy of broken gene and let this gene to start functioning to repair DNA and be able to prevent developing of other diseases. Unfortunately, I know also that when tumors develop, these tumors are more susceptible to PARP inhibitors. This is, I know that for patients with breast and several other cancer types, ovarian, like BRCA loss, ATM loss, ATR, this is currently a novel treatments that are being developed. But again, conceptually, we need progress. We need a breakthrough in gene therapy to be able to fix these broken genes.
Okay. Is tall cell variant associated with any syndromes or genes? And how do you go about doing testing for this?
Tall cell variant is rarely, I don't want to say never, because nothing in human body is never. But the moment you say never, then you see after 3,000 following the rule one that will not follow the rule, but almost never part of any kind of an inherited syndromes. Tall cell variant typically develops with the mechanism of somatic BRAF V600E mutations. I would say that 97% of this tall cell variant of papillary carcinoma that develop by activating of BRAF through BRAF V600E. And another maybe 3% remaining, they develop through the mechanism of BRAF gene fusions, very similar mechanism. Typically, both events are somatic, they acquired mutations, and they are not inherited.
Okay, thank you. Another question. How often do you see clinical Cowden diagnosis not be confirmed on genetic testing?
I'm sorry, but I'm not qualified to answer this question. I work on diagnosing disease, detecting mutations, but I don't run the germline clinic. So usually when we see it, I describe your scenario. We see, for example, I give an example. We see a 30-year-old woman with thyroid nodules and with one dominant nodule, and they stick a needle sent for analysis, and we see PTEN mutation. Okay. Younger patient, PTEN mutation, it's obviously a concern. We put in the report that, based on the age and PTEN mutation, please consider exploring family history and genetic counseling. So we recommend that the clinicians to send patients to genetic counseling to look at the history, to look at the manifestations, and if there are some suspicion, to draw blood and send for germline testing. But I don't know, we don't do that second part to then correlate and see how often we see it. I'm sorry, but I'm not qualified to answer on this question.
And just kind of on a personal note, I know when our family was being seen for the PTEN and potential Cowden syndrome, we went to see Dr. Eng, ENG, at the Cleveland Clinic. She was kind of the guru, I think, in that area for diagnosis.
She's definitely one of the most experienced, not in this country, in the world, person on PTEN syndrome. I mean, if you have any, and she is very, very nice as a person, she's very approachable, she really caring about patients. So if you have family situation when it's not clear, there is a discrepancy, I agree with them, I would strongly recommend you to try to contact her.
Yes, she'd be happy to see anybody. Thank you.
Okay, I'll go ahead and read the next question. Other than ClinVar, I might not be saying that right, what is another database to look at to see if the mutation noted in PTEN or DICER are found to be germline? As a pathologist, can you clarify if there is any regulations for reporting of germline mutations for sharing with the patient and the medical community?
So both are very good questions. So the first question is, you, by the way, Jody, you pronounce it very exactly. This is ClinVar.
Oh, okay.
So this is a main database, not the only database. There is a number of other databases for different type of mutations. So sometimes we look at cosmic database, sometimes we look at Oncotype KB database, but they're mostly somatic mutation. ClinVar is an important database for the for germline mutations. We look at multiple in silico predictions. There is a number of in silico prediction algorithms. So it's like there is really a lot of tools, a lot of tools. Then there are obviously guidelines. There are guidelines for somatic mutation and guidelines for germline mutations. When you go through the multiple factors and it includes what is reported. I mean, a number, I can tell you that's exactly what we do every day. Every day, you know, when I come to work, we have this, we detect variants and we have some, and we have to make a determination if this is a so-called tier 1-2 variant, which is functional. We know that it's a functional, this is true variant, or it's a benign variant, or it's a so-called VUS variant of uncertain significance. And trust me, I mean, we have our genomic analysts, PhDs, we have our fellows, we have a pathologist doing this. I mean, it's still not perfect. Sometimes it's easy, sometimes it's very difficult. Okay, so we obviously look for various databases. You know, International Agency Research of Cancer has a database for P53, for example, germline mutations versus somatic mutations. Really, that's what I can say. ClinVar is absolutely on the top of this list for germline mutations because this is something that obviously is most complete. Sometimes we have to just go and read individual papers. We always have our fellows going and reading papers and seeing is anything published, because one of the criterion for mutation is published functional evidence. You know, that's what we do in research labs when we take these mutations, induce them in cells and see if these mutations affect or doesn't affect function of the gene. It's a very complex, and we follow the guidelines, but again, it's all dealt on the kind of mutation by mutation basis. I'm sorry, what was the second question?
I think you answered it just regarding the database. Another quick kind of side note that I know VUSs are very difficult. I know with my family, 15 years ago, we were diagnosed with the VUS, but then they went through, I don't know if it was the database or what they did to test it again to see if it continued to be a VUS, because as you know, research can change in 15 years. So maybe important to get that looked at again, compared through the database, you know, if you know, like I said, a P10 diagnosis of VUS was made years ago, to see if anything has been updated or changed, so.
You're absolutely right. This is very important. Very important. Very rarely, sometimes it's happened in opposite. We give them tier 1-2 and then we downgrade it, yes, to VUS variant.
Yes.
But in a number of situations, more and more data, more and more data. This is where we need the world, we will need to world community of researchers to keep studying this individual genes, individual hotspots, because that's the only way how we'll eventually find. Yeah. And you're absolutely right. We try to do it, you know, every couple of years to go and just see what is new, how it's reclassified, and so it's challenging because it takes a lot of time, but you're absolutely right. Mm-hmm. we have a number of situations when something that we called in the past VUS, mm-hmm. today we would reclassify as tier one too.
Another question we have you seen any correlation between papillary thyroid cancer and soft tissue epithelioid sarcoma? I'm sure I pronounced that wrong, but you know what I mean.
Yes. I'm just thinking, I don't think so, no.
No.
That's. Okay. I don't know any syndromic... soft tissue. Werner syndrome, there is an extremely rare, it is a very rare, there is a very rare disease which is called Werner syndrome. If I'm not mistaken, you may want to read about it. Werner is WERNER, Werner syndrome. Just maybe read a little bit about that syndrome, okay? Because if I'm not mistaken, I have come across one or two patients that have a sarcomatoid lesions, not necessarily epithelioid sarcomas, because it's also very rare tumors, but sarcomatous lesions in these patients. Perhaps if you investigate it, maybe there would be any other than that, for more common, if you're talking about various fibromatosis type lesions, then APC, adenomatous coli, obviously something that must be considered, very seriously considered, APC or adenomatous polyposis coli.
Okay, thank you.
If you're talking about PTEN or DICER, I'm not sure that I know about any known associations.
Great, so we're doing really good. We have about 6 minutes left and a few more questions. I'm gonna read the next one. I'm 20 years post original diagnosis, which happened at the age of 21, with persistent RAI non-avid disease in lungs. Genomic testing of tumors was not standard 20 years ago. Are there options to test for syndromes or mutations with blood tests, or are the testing of tumors the only option?
Generally speaking, I would recommend testing the tumor. I'm not recommending liquid biopsy. I think there is now a lot of fuss about it. I don't really think that this is something that in this particular scenario would be beneficial. But I want to tell you that your tumor was removed 20 years ago. This tumor can be still tested. It doesn't need to be a fresh tissue. I would strongly recommend you to try to find the documentation where, at what hospital your surgery was performed. Unfortunately, I think that by regulation, paraffin blocks have to be kept, I don't remember, between 10 and 20 years. Most academic centers keep it forever, okay? Some, unfortunately, discard. But if you are able to pull out the documentation and you know where your surgery was performed 20 years ago, and you can contact them and they can find your paraffin blocks, you can test that tumor. It's always sort of first recommendation for us is to try to test a new metastatic disease. If you have a lung disease, to try to, if it's possible, if it's technically possible to collect, to get a biopsy, to then and do genetic testing. But if not, I can tell you, even testing of 20 years tumors will tell you maybe probably 90% of information. And I want to tell you that you are a young person, I can tell you that it will be very, very important for you, because younger patients have a higher tendency. We are not talking about familial disease probably here, we are talking about somatic disease, but younger individuals have significantly higher chance to have gene fusions, not like BRAF mutations, point mutations, but gene fusions. I hope that somebody in this meeting will cover this topic. So, and now what is very exciting, that a number of these gene fusions, they are targetable. Now there are excellent, excellent inhibitors that can really stop and or put into this disease in remission. So there are RET inhibitors, there are NTRK inhibitors, there are ALK inhibitors. So it would make perfect sense for you to test this tumor, even if your disease now is not progressing. In case if start progressing, you would have at hand very powerful drugs to stop it from progressing. So try to look for your old tumor and try to, and if you find it, send it for, have your physician to send it for molecular test.
Okay, thank you. We have about 2 minutes left. Maybe this is a good question here. Are there any resources for patients that are clinically diagnosed and positive for these hereditary syndromes that you can give?
Well, for PTEN, again, for PTEN, this is a Cleveland Clinic has a website, excellent website that give a lot of information. For DICER1, I have to confess that I don't know, but I want to tell you something. There is a physician. He is a geneticist. He practices at McGill in Montreal, Canada. His name is William Foulkes, F-O-U-L Foulkes, mm-hmm. K-E-S. Mm-hmm. He's an outstanding individual. Mm-hmm. He's an outstanding physician. He cares so much about the patients. He is one of the person who has a lot of experience with DICER1. So that's probably writing to him. Also, he's very approachable, writing to him and asking for additional resources. That he would be the best person to approach. And I don't know, Pam, if you know somebody else.
I do. And I've met with Dr. Foulkes and he is wonderful. Also, we're currently, have appointments with Dr. Chris Ann Schultz, S-C-H-U-L-T-Z. She's out of the Children's Hospital in Minneapolis, Minnesota, and she keeps the DICER1 registries. Okay. So to be in contact with her, again, she is very approachable, very knowledgeable. She has given us a lot of information about DICER1 and surveillance.
Wonderful.
Okay. All right. I think can about wrap things up. So thank you everybody for joining us, and especially Dr. Nikiforov, thank you so much. Very informative, comprehensive session, and thank you for everything you do for ThyCa and for answering all of our questions.
Thank you all, and good luck to everybody.
Thank you.
Stay well. Bye-bye.